Step into the captivating world of broadcast news at the summer exhibition at Wireless Hill Museum with journeys through Western Australia's remarkable telecast heritage. The evolution of news broadcasting in WA, from its humble beginnings to the 24-hour news cycle that dominates our screens today, is brought to life in this exhibition presented by Wireless Hill in partnership with Pictures in Motion, Western Australia's Museum of Film and Television. This exhibition runs from Sunday, the 21st of January, 2024 to Sunday, the 5th of May, 2024.
Let's start by referring to the technology. Ken has just given me this microphone to clip on. And if we go back to the use of the Oricon 16mm camera in our first days at Channel 7, you had a handheld mic with a windsock which probably distorted more than helped, and you had to hold the microphone as you asked the question and then poke it right under the nose of the person being interviewed, and if there was any wind blowing, became outrageous distortion. There were many events which were quite historic.
I have a great healthy
mind. Senator Kennedy has been shot.
Perth changed dramatically in the 60s. Up until Eric Edgar Cook and the mass killings, Perth was a free city.
Perth, city on the Swan. Charm and glamour mark a distinctive of the capital of Western Australia.
Very quiet place, people still getting around in their pinstripe double-breasted suits in the middle of summer.
Some of you have remarked about the ladies' hats and their dresses. I wonder what they'll say in 50 years' time when they look back at these pictures.
All of a sudden, Perth literally became a city of terror.
A mystery gunman shot two people dead in Vincent and Louise Streets, Netherlands.
I don't think we've seen the city before or since gripped in such a way.
A third man was critically wounded and the gunman fired upon two other people sitting in a parked car.
I think it was a fear born of utter helplessness because people just didn't know where this killer was.
The gunman vanished into the night as mysteriously as he had arrived. He left few clues.
I know of stories of people actually crawling to the door and peeking out through the window. It was genuinely a very, very frightening period.
Well, in the catches the desperation.
Technology has made great advances.
Holocaust, inferno, fireball. Who can adequately describe the scene here dwelling up today?
Cinders being fired 500 metres ahead of the fire, and the town was totally devastated.
Stories to be told here today and dwelling up are varied and sad and shocking.
We looked out and we could see the flame is leaping right around.
Most of them lost everything. There was just a shell of a town.
It shall be the policy of this
hour on CBW. Thousands of people gathered at the mall. think that although you poor simple people have been voting for me for 15 years...
Robert Menzies was one of the world's great orators.
You've been voting for an utter fraud.
There were always people prepared to interject at Menzies, but they did it at their own risk.
Chap down here, clever fella, very clever chap. And who caused all this trouble with Malaysia and Indonesia? I said, well, I suppose I did. My name must be Sukarno.
In the
Busselton
area, fallen rivers broke their banks to extend them.
One of the most significant events that took place in Perth was the demolishing of the barracks.
The wave of controversy and the storm of protest.
There was a public outcry, and I mean, there were protest marches.
State cabinet seemed bent on demolition.
Stand by, tell us any one and two with news titles. We're all together. Take four. Ready, one on reader. Take one and cue him.
Good evening, everyone. A few minutes ago, the ABC's television station in Perth, ABW Channel 2, was officially opened by the Postmaster General, Mr. Davidson. Tonight, we look back on the 60s.
In the morning, a town had died.
Swirling floodwaters were flowing through the town at a rate of about 20 knots. The 10-man crew had to abandon ship.
The guest of honour at the Commonwealth Games, the Duke of Edinburgh.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor, and all the people of Perth.
The fastest thing ever seen on water anywhere in the world.
Die-hard cricket fan want to watch his game from behind a wire fence.
As far as Charles Court was concerned, Australia, and indeed the whole world, revolved around WA.
New South Wales Court of Appeal today unanimously quashed Mr. Justice Lionel Murphy's...
...threatening to break Telecom's monopoly on providing...
Good evening, David Ellery with the Weekend National.
Good evening, welcome to the National.
The Barlow and Chambers families are left with their grief.
For $63, you get a tape which has a noise similar to lapping water on it.
In and around the hamlet appear complete.
There are vocals, Bob Mundell, there you go.
Party's business will be discussed within the party. And
successful, she'll be Australia's first female premier.
Until we have land rights in this state.
Organised by the National Aboriginal Conference.
The Aborigines are convinced that this land is
necessary because I think it's a danger that we're forgetting that there are people.
While the state government's intervention.
At the time that your father was hanged,
Liz Davenport is confident of winning her case, and she's
fine and mild. You'll get it when I get in there.
You just call me a scumbag.
Oil began spilling from the Kirky
as the fire raged out of control.
Our premiers for the second time in three seasons.
Swan Districts has also had a great year.
The West Coast Eagles have received...
Now, outside in Perth at the moment.
Quite how damaging is all this for?
I'm joined now by state political...
And now with today's news and sport, here's...
And that's all from ABC News for the moment.
In the prime viewing hours, Channel 2, the station that traditionally lags in the ratings, led the field.
Good evening, I'm Alan Carpenter. Welcome to the first edition of Stateline.
Mr. Singleton later told him about a meeting involving Laurie Connell.
Peter, the pro-life MPs certainly want to debate some amendments.
I'm Gillian O'Shaughnessy.
Now repeating tonight's headline stories.
Strong easterly winds had whipped up the fire burning on a huge front.
But many West Australians were not prepared to accept the destruction by man of the historic old barracks.
Good evening, welcome to Stateline.
Welcome to Stateline, I'm Tom Batley.
But it was really only this year that the Triple C's reputation went national. It's been almost 2 years since three truck drivers were killed in a ferocious bushfire. Perth is increasingly using surveillance technology to watch our every move.
Now, here's David.
Thank you, Peter.
Warm night for Perth last night.
And that's our sport on a busy Saturday night.
Let us deal with the southern half first of all.
Karen Tai has more. Alicia, an impressive display from Australia's bowlers.
Quite a cold night last night. We got down to 3.6.
As Australia charges towards victory with a day to play in the second test.
Perth tomorrow, sunny. A minimum of 13, a top of 24.
Interstate tomorrow, we can look forward to late storms in Darwin.
Now here with the weather is Dennis Buckley.
Thanks, Kevin. Good evening.
Last summer, City Beach was in the news as the scene of a brief excursion into the forbidden realm of topless sunbaking.
This little volume that owes so much to the 19th century that it's soon to be serialised by the BBC explains various concepts like Section 99 will stop you discharging any cannon or other firearm of greater calibre than a common fowling piece.
Well, I'm told this is perhaps the ultimate deterrent for thieves. Oh! Oh!
One of these people could be Western Australia's 1 millionth citizen. The identity of Western Australia's 1 millionth citizen is unimportant.
This machine allows you to edit what you're writing before it's typed onto the paper.
Well, Frank, what do you think of this latest invasion to the man's world, women jockeys?
Well, really, Bob, they've invaded our world for quite a few centuries. Now we can't do without them, you know.
Hey, well, Frank, I don't think these girls are all that serious. They're just out for a bit of fun. Frank's been saying pretty nice things about women jockeys, much to my surprise. Do you want to become a women jockey or just in this for fun on Sunday?
I think it's just for fun.
Good evening.
Good evening. David Ellery in Perth.
Good evening. Deborah Kennedy with ABC News.
This is ABC News.
This is ABC News.
This is ABC News. Good evening, I'm Karina Cavaglio.
ABC News.
ABC News.
Welcome to This Day Tonight.
And joining me is Commission reporter Alan Carpenter.
It has been very difficult.
This innocent-looking Subiaco office building features prominently in one of the slickest plots ever designed to defraud the Perth Mint of Gold.
Farmers say they don't have any problems distinguishing between the ducks.
Following the allegations of bias,
this is the aftermath.
It's a local station and it's got a fierce policy of promoting that which is Albany.
Witnesses say at least 15 shots were fired.
A laser light orbits the object, in this case my head, and reads the terrain.
The 150 hectares, that's about 370 acres of land.
We're now being told that jeans, tight jeans, make you fat.
Others in the community haven't been so lucky.
Basically, the argument against Operation No goes something like this. It's the Mr. Bigs who get the drugs, import them and then divide them.
And now a step back in time to news from decades past.
I would like to enter politics at some time, yeah.
And who's this earnest scholar from 1971?
Well, I hope to go to St John's College, Oxford, next year.
Jeff Gallop, now Western Australia's opposition leader.
Theatregoers who have been complaining about the rash of realistic kitchen sink dramas.
This is the eighth day of the metalworkers' strike, and here outside Vickers Hoskins in Bassendean, the men are lining up for their pay.
All was quiet there this morning until a tiny delivery van took the strikers by surprise. Once it was realised the driver was a woman, the incident was taken only semi-seriously.
Opponents remain hopeful West Australians will reject daylight saving.
Vote yes for daylight saving!
West Australians have rejected daylight saving.
Don't like it at all.
The anti-daylight saving lobby need no longer worry.
Well, I think it's really beautiful.
While people continue to debate whether or not daylight saving fades the paintwork,
daylight saving is no more.
Howard Ware has 44 years of television experience. He's currently a TV news director for the ABC in Perth.
OK, stand by studio. We're on air in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Opening's rolling. Stand by on the floor. And cue.
So this is where our newsreader sits, and although I've got two cameras pointed at me, there's no one else in the room. Everything's controlled by Howard outside.
So when it comes to news, you're not just the director, you're the cameraman.
I'm the cameraman, the audio operator, the character generator operator, the director, the vision mixer, everything. The only other person in the control room is actually the producer, and they have a pure editorial function.
Now, I saw you using what looks like a glorified computer game over there. Explain that to us.
That's actually the controller for all three cameras. I can program into those cameras all the shots I require beforehand, any movements I require beforehand, and even have the facilities for moving the cameras around the studio, and they find out where they are from a barcode system on the walls. These new cameras that we're using now, they are designed to be controlled by a computer, whereas perhaps the older cameras are designed to be used by with people.
The attack gave New Zealand's artillery battery their first chance at going into attack. They manned howitzer cannons at them.
Let's have a look around Western Australia today.
News tonight at 6.
In the last 25 years, technology has brought the world to us in the most instant and at times confronting of ways.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Berlin Wall was massive. It was Europe was going through an extraordinary change, and it was a time when you could get information and pictures out, you know, on the second. You could actually see the wall coming down, you know, the sledgehammers and the hammers, people standing on top of the wall, and we had correspondents there every day, and you could see it unfolding in front of your eyes. Probably the best example of the change in the way news was being delivered to people here in Perth, the Gulf War. It was extraordinary. You could see the rockets being launched and at night going over the top of cities, and we started to see incidents where you couldn't have them, where you didn't have a picture of them.
They provided some of the most memorable images of the Gulf War.
Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts. You are the grace that blazed yourselves.
where lives were torn apart.
I remember Princess Diana. Everybody remembers where, of my generation, remembers where they were when they heard the news that she was, she had been in a car accident originally. I was about to start the city of surf. I was in my tracky dacks and was called in. The princess had been in an accident, and to get straight out to Chewett Hill, by the time I got there, she was dead. And I spent the rest of the day doing updates to and from London on that world event as it unfolded.
Your legend ever will.
Exactly where I was when 9/11 happened. Steve Pennells, who's won a Walkley Award, was the chief of staff at Channel 9 then. He rang at about 8 o'clock at night and said a plane's flown into one of the towers in New York. He rang the newsroom just to see what are we doing. We're trying to get hold of Peter Holland and Tina Altieri, we're reading then. And we couldn't get hold of Peter or Tina, so jumped in the car. And I remember we just jumping onto the set, putting on a jacket and a tie, and just writing down a few notes. I didn't want anything in the auto cue. And I remember just saying, we've got, you know, an extraordinary series of events that's unfolding in New York. It's like a nightmare, but it's true. And just went through it, then we threw to the live pictures. And that's the biggest event that I can remember on an international scale. I think that changed the way we see things forever.
I guess probably the story that had the biggest impact on me and some of my friends and colleagues at Channel 9 in the most recent time was the Bali bombings in 2002. A colleague of ours, Mark Reddings, was in Bali when those bombs went off, and we started, you know, as you do, you get a call in the middle of the night to say there's been this incredible event, get to the office.
Got a call at 1 o'clock in the morning. It was a Saturday night. Mark Reddings, Skeet Reddings, who was working here at 9, rang and said, mate, I'm in Bali. Something's happened here. All hell's broken loose. I specifically remember saying that. All hell is broken loose. It's a bomb, or it might be a gas explosion, but there's got to be people dead. It's chaos up here. He happened to be inside one of the clubs when the bomb went off. He stumbled out dazed and then turned left in the street, and then the second bomb went off. As he says, if he turned right, he would have walked straight into the second bomb.
I was standing inside Paddy's Bar, which is now a blackened wreck behind me, when the first bomb exploded. Less than 60 seconds later, and with people running for their lives, a second bomb went off across the street.
That was an incredibly difficult time for Mark. He did an extraordinary job, did an incredible job.
And reported around the world the story, firstly as a participant, and then, you know, he became an observer to what was unfolding.
So he was a victim as well, as a reporter. How he managed to do both jobs, I don't know. On an international scale, we felt something very close to home.
When you're here amongst a tragedy like this, it just hits home so much what a lucky country Australia is to live in, and conversely, how close we all came to losing even more people. That is where
I should be. I worked at Nine from 2003 until 2009, so there was a lot of major stories that happened in that time, and I guess it's the big ones that will stay with you forever, like the Boxing Day tsunami in 2004, and that was just a story that affected so many people.
Everyone remembers the moment that terror struck. Thin line between life and death found here, as a man pins his hopes to the branch of a tree.
Along with the Black Saturday bushfires in Victoria, I remember being at work on that day and seeing those pictures come in for people, you know, that their whole lives basically being destroyed, and that's something that you'll never forget.
One of the stories that I really loved being involved with was the royal wedding. I was producing the bulletin on the day, and I think we all had a sense of what a big deal this was and what a special day it was. We'd all seen Diana's wedding in the years before, and for Princess Kate and Prince William to be getting married, this gorgeous young couple, was so exciting for everyone.
Hi, William Arthur Philip Louis.
Take thee, Catherine Elizabeth.
Take thee, Catherine Elizabeth.
To my wedded wife.
To my wedded wife.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death us do part.
Till death us do part.
I have to admit, I did put the bulletin to air wearing a tiara. I got right into the spirit of it, and I just loved it. That first lot of vision that came in with Kate's dress and the bridesmaids and the whole thing, it was just a really special day. And for a change, doing something so positive and being part of a news story that we knew was part of history was really special. Well, it's just not too-
Perth, Eyewitness News.
Good evening and welcome to this historic first edition of Eyewitness News.
Also an exciting base to broadcast live events. The Bulletin took on a new look, presented out of Sydney.
Hello everyone, welcome to 10 News.
But also the stories were still coming out of Perth.
Police won't confirm reports Mrs. Rainey had recently received a series of threatening emails.
On the lookout today, we have seen schools of salmon which could attract sharks.
Then there was a shift back west.
This is 10 News.
The Dianella Studios have been our home for almost three decades.
Good evening, thanks for joining us tonight.
Join us live from our new studios in Subiaco.
Hey, her, here's something new. Hey, hey, her, hey. We give you 10. Where's new? Channel 10. Hey, hey, her, hey. We give you 10. Where's new? Channel 10. Where's new? Channel 10.
A team of nearly 50 people. We'll bring you the news nightly.
Hi, I'm Ian Brayshaw, and every night I'll bring you the very best in sport.
And I'm your weatherman, John Barnett, and I'll be keeping you right up to date with all the highs and the occasional lows of life in this great state.
Show you the world at its worst. We show you the world at its best. But the world that matters the most is our world right here in the West. There's drama right here every day of the year. We'll show you Perth for all the world at 5:30 p.m. News on 10 is first.
Is first in Perth.
Weeknights, Norelda Jacobs presents 10 News at 5.
You're watching 10 News live from Perth. I'm Norelda Jacobs.
10's News Evolution is coming. Our trusted 5pm news continues with new presenter Craig Smart. Then, an Australian first. 6pm with George Negus.
On the big issues that really matter, we'll take the time to tell you not just what's happening, but why.
Then at 6:30, we make WA the focus with the stories that most affect you.
No matter what time you get home, 10's got your news covered.
TVW Channel 7 opened on Friday, October the 16th, 1959. There were two studio cameramen, Gordon McColl and me, Richard Ashton, ready for the first news broadcast to go to air to the Perth region on that night. An invitation to attend the final news on Sunday evening of February the 22nd, 2015, had been kindly made to me by Chris Wharton, CEO of Seven West Media WA. After my 40 years at Channel 7, there had been, of course, many news broadcasts and many news personalities reading the news right through to the present day. Sunday night's news for the final time at Tuart Hill was going to be presented by Samantha Jolly. Now, 56 years on, I was here again, looking down into Studio One. Yes, it was still the same, and brought back a host of memories. Into the control room now, I was happily greeted by news director Paul Giglia and director's assistant Robin Hemingway, and graphics assistant Christina Simich. Seated at the back was news producer Alison Hembro. Now in the studio news set, Samantha readied herself for the broadcast. Cameraman Ray Rabb was setting up the camera shot for the main news set. Across to the side of the studio, Sabrina Hemingway was setting up the audio cue equipment with the readout of tonight's news script.
This is 7 News.
Tonight, terrified Perth residents witness a suburban shooting. A man incinerated in a shocking crash. Exclusive, a Perth father's plea after vandals desecrate his son's memorial.
And how a boy band attended the Eagles pre-season training.
And through to three, you're on. Stand by one.
Samantha Jolly.
And Q-Sam.
Good evening. Those stories soon, but first to breaking news. And there's trouble in our suburbs tonight. Monique Dirks is in Forest Field. Monique, what's happening there?
Well, Sam, dozens of police officers have been called here this afternoon.
Now, it isn't clear why they decided to arm themselves.
Jeff McCann was technical director. He sets up and monitors all the engineering transmission facilities for the news going to air.
Locals on the streets while the community is on edge, Sam.
The Gold Coast Titans are in complete crisis.
Rolling over.
Arriving home to a scandal of titanic proportions. Two of the game's big names. With notices to appear in court on drug-related charges.
Titans Greg Bird and David Taylor, the latest players allegedly involved in an ongoing drugs probe that threatens to end their embattled club.
Taylor was shielded by team officials as he was whisked away in a waiting car.
All was fitting together quite nicely. Robin's stories were coming up on cue, and Paul, following the script, makes the choices of camera shots and inserts and switches them to air. Now we're in the audio control room. Jeff Lenz was controlling the sound faders.
3, 2, 1, cue. Indonesians have rallied against...
We see him monitoring the sound levels, and there are views of the auto scripts on his monitors.
Organisers in Jakarta collected coin donations in a symbolic gesture to repay the $1 billion pledged by John Howard after the Aceh tsunami.
On the streets of Jakarta, anger towards...
Samantha introduces the next story.
We've brought you stories before about aircraft boneyards, those giant areas in the American desert where entire fleets of passenger planes go when they've passed their use-by date. But this military boneyard with thousands of warplanes stored for parts is an even more impressive sight.
In all, $35 billion worth of military firepower, which once protected the skies around the world, now sitting waiting for their final orders.
The stories continue, and we follow them, of course, through the sports stories, and then, of course, there's the weather.
Bracing for more cold weather. A new pair of storms is set to lash 30 states over the weekend, bringing heavy snow, rain and temperatures below freezing. 1,400 flights have already been cancelled. The Arctic blast is being blamed for at least 30...
Then almost suddenly the news broadcast comes to a close.
And that's all from the 7 News team for now. I'll have updates throughout the evening.
It's time for goodbye pictures in the old studios. The whole crew assembles for goodbye photographs, sitting on the old news desk. All the pictures are taken from everyone's cameras. Even I get a look in, sitting on the corner of the desk next to Robin.
is.
Oh, dear.
You and your panorama.
Sebi? Sebi?
On top of Mount Cutha, inside the studios of 7 Brisbane, Queensland's largest film archive, every roll of film, every videotape from Channel 7 Brisbane, Sydney, Melbourne, Adelaide and Perth, all trucked here, ready for preservation.
It's been a huge job, massive years in the making, and it's going to go for many years to come.
Machines long since retired, brought back to life by a technician who'd long since retired. Peter Poulton began working here in 1964. He retired in 2002, but came back for a project of national significance.
Yeah, we keep them going. I mean, they all still operate beautiful.
But the old tapes were not.
It was a decision that I didn't take lightly.
They'd play like this, with creases, until the 7Lab team worked their magic. How'd they do it? They'd bake the tapes in chicken egg incubators.
These actually take the moisture out of the tapes. And eventually, when you put them in the machine again, they will play nice and smoothly through the tape mechanism and won't squeal and give you a perfect picture.
Perfect, all right. They're digitised and stored forever. Then there's the film. Every roll scanned, stabilised, colour graded. The scratches digitally removed.
The way things are going, Oxenford will soon be another ghost town.
When these stories first aired decades ago, they were on fuzzy TV screens. Now we're seeing them in high definition.
Just go forward.
Go forward a bit. My God! Oh, no.
Oh, Reed.
Okay, move him.
Oh, dear.
Just go and move him. Put them somewhere else. You'll be right to move.
We get better all the time.
Step into the captivating world of broadcast news at the summer exhibition at Wireless Hill Museum with journeys through Western Australia's remarkable telecast heritage. The evolution of news broadcasting in WA, from its humble beginnings to the 24-hour news cycle that dominates our screens today, is brought to life in this exhibition presented by Wireless Hill in partnership with Pictures in Motion, Western Australia's Museum of Film and Television. This exhibition runs from Sunday, the 21st of January, 2024 to Sunday, the 5th of May, 2024.